Now we go to the next program, pre-launch session, Symposium on Non-STEM, a Case-Based Approach. May I request Dr. Amal Kumar Banerjee to moderate the session and call upon the expert panelist. The presenter will be Dr. Devanu Ghosh Rai, and the expert panelist will be Dr. Mrinal Kanti Das, Dr. Shubhro Banerjee, Dr. Jayanto Shaha, and Dr. Dhiman Bonik. Sir, please come over.
Good afternoon, my friends. Now we are going for a very important discussion on the non-STEMI ACS. We have with us Dr. M.K. Das as a expert panelist, Dr. Shubhro Banerjee, Dr. Jayanto Shaha, and Dhiman Bonik. To facilitate the very good discussion, I request all the panelists, you will be asked, when you will be asked, you will answer. If anybody has something to add or say, they will raise your thumb, then we know that you have something to say. Now I request Devanu Ghosh Rai to start the case.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is a case which I had a lot of problem recently, so I'm presenting this case to you. This is a 70 years old male patient who had recurrent episodes of severe chest pain for the last 3 days. There was no radiation. Each episode lasted for 15 to 30 minutes. It was associated with breathing difficulty and sweating. Patient is a known hypertensive and is on Amlong 5 milligram daily. There is no diabetes and he is a smoker.
Stop here. Now I request Dr. Dhiman Bonik to give his impression from this history, from some clinical part. What is your suspicion, clinical suspicion?
The patient is, Amlong is, I think, Amlong is an amlodipine.
Amlodipine.
He's hypertensive, non-diabetic, having a recurrent episodes of chest pain, which lasted for 15 to 30 minutes, associated with breathing difficulty and sweating. He is non-diabetic. It's supposed to be a critical stenosis in more than one or two vessels. It may be...
What should be the clinical diagnosis?
Clinical diagnosis is... it is a case of chronic stable angina with CCS class 3.
One thing, Dr. Bonik, I like to emphasize, the patient is having the de novo chest pain lasting more than 20 minutes. So, we must have some suspicion he is having any acute ischemic episode like ACS. Now, I request Dr. Shubhro Banerjee, what is your option regarding the case?
Can I also ask, like, what this sort of this pain was brought in by, some was precipitated by something? What brought this pain, or what, did it happen just at rest?
No, there was no precipitating event.
Okay, so it's a pain at rest.
Yeah, patient
so
was
pain
at rest only.
At rest, which lasted for 15 to 30 minutes and associated with the shortness of breath and sweating in a 70-year-old man with smoker, who is a smoker and has hypertension. I think one thing we have certainly have to exclude is acute coronary syndrome.
Okay, so thank you, Shubhro. Now, Mrinal, what information do you want more for this patient? So this patient is being very admitted or is come to a hospital. What next investigation you want? Just one line.
A few of the things I will want to know from the history itself also, whether the patient was on aspirin or not.
Okay, now before going to the ACS, yes, there is a relevant point, but my question to you, that what other information or what investigation immediately the patient like this being presented at the emergency, what should be your investigation on presentation?
On presentation, since the patient we are dealing with appears to be suffering from acute coronary syndrome, I will straight away go for the ECG. And in the ECG, I will determine what are the things.
What are the ECG. Okay. That's fine. We call any biomarker test?
Biomarker test, after seeing the ECG, then I will decide whether I should go for the biomarker test or not.
Thank you. Now, Devanu, proceed.
So, what we did was that, as you have clearly said, we went for an ECG and biomarker test. We checked the troponins. So, actually, the course is he was seen at the local hospital and ECG reported was normal. Patient was started on nitrocontin and statin ASP and he was referred to Kolkata.
Okay, you keep this slide. Joyanto, the patient has been reported to have the normal ECG. Now, naturally, the question comes, if a patient coming to hospital whose provisional diagnosis might be the acute coronary syndrome, how many cases may present with normal ECG?
About 30 to 50% of the patients, about 30 to 50% of the patients with non-ST elevation MI or ACS may have normal ECG. So just having an ECG being normal this time doesn't exclude the diagnosis of ACS.
Okay, one more thing, Joyanto, that a patient presenting with a normal ECG, do you have any more option for the change the leads going beyond that?
Definitely, some of the areas of the heart are not routinely taken up by the surface ECGs. We need to check the circumflex territory with V7, V8 leads, the acute marginal branches, those are also often missed with the 12 lead ECG, so we need to take the right-sided leads.
So okay, thank you. Proceed.
So on examination, pulse rate was 66 per minute, blood pressure was 140 by 80 millimeter of mercury, cardiovascular examination was normal, chest was clear, and troponins were positive. Now this is the 12 lead ECG. As you can see, there is sinus bradycardia. Otherwise, the ECG was normal. So we went ahead and did a V7, V8 lead also. And that is also normal. So clearly, there were no ECG changes.
Okay. Before proceeding further, I request Dr. Bonik, what should be your next step with the patient? You know the sum of the information. Preliminary investigations in the setting the suspected to be acute coronary syndrome. What next you will do?
As the patient is 70 years old, he's having bradycardia with chest pain, and he is having amlodipine, which may even increase the heart rate. But the heart rate is almost in bradycardia level. So the next possible investigation is doing an angiogram.
Now, Shubhro, before going for the angiography, what should be the immediate pharmacotherapy?
See, first, this is a patient who seems to have acute coronary syndrome, but again, the ECG is normal. Although it's possible for patients with ACS to have a normal ECG, I would make it clear that I actually exclude other causes, maybe cardiac or non-cardiac causes, which may present with chest pain and have a normal ECG. And I will just make a clinical examination to check the pulses on both arms and make sure the pulses are, the volume is fine. In fact, I am actually excluding dissection. Or I don't think this is a pulmonary embolism. I don't think it's a myopericarditis. And the history is not really suggestive of Takotsubo syndrome. So these are the things which you would like to exclude. But at the same time, once this is done, there are two other things I will do. I'll get a chest x-ray done to see if there is
any... No, I'm just asking you that you know the clinical features, and of course you are right to exclude, say, pulmonary embolism or aortic dissection. We may go for the echocardiography. That facility is available?
Yes.
Then taking it to be granted that we are dealing with this sort of case, ECG, what presenter reported, that even the reported ECG is within normal limits, as reported by, rightly mentioned by Joyanto, that up to one-third or more patients with non-ST elevation MI, they might have the normal ECG. Now, But the medical management, rather pharmacotherapy, we should resort to.
Right. And I think we know that the TROP-T is also positive.
Yeah, TROP-T positive is a de novo persistent pain, chest pain.
Yeah.
Possibly no other cardiac events. I mean the non-coronary events like dissection or the pulmonary embolism or something like that. Or rather non-cardiac causes. Right.
So in this case, the diagnosis of ACS is very likely. And I would start him on antiplatelets. And also...
What antiplatelet do you prefer?
I'll give him aspirin, of course. And a second antiplatelet that I would use could be either clopidogrel or preferably ticagrelor. Not prasugrel.
The patient is already on aspirin.
Okay, so I'll add in ticagrelor.
And patient has slight bradycardia.
This slight bradycardia, I do not think would be a contraindication to use ticagrelor.
Anyway, we thought that this was... We thought that it was classical chest pain suggestive of acute coronary syndrome with TROP-T positive, and especially qualitative TROP-T positive. It's almost 99.9% it is acute coronary syndrome.
Yeah. Yes.
But still, we thought it was very likely to be ACS. But still we kept in mind ECG segment, ECG changes in non-STEMI could be ST segment depression and T wave inversion, dynamic ST segment depression, transient ST segment elevation, deep T wave inversion and normal or non-diagnostic ECG. So we have already discussed this, about 1/3 to 50% patients have normal or non-diagnostic ECG. We also thought of other possibilities like elevation of troponin in the absence of ischemic heart disease, which could be because of heart failure, pulmonary embolism, renal failure, aortic dissection, stroke, and subarachnoid hemorrhage, critically ill patients with sepsis, pericarditis, and Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. But our clinical setting was not fitting with any of these things. So what we did the other investigations. Hemoglobin was low, 9.3, and ESR was slightly high, 73. Blood sugar was normal. Sodium, potassium were normal. Creatinine was normal. Cholesterol, 175. HDL, 44. Urine showed some pustules. And this is the echo did. We did the immediate echo, and you can see this echo report. It shows concentric LVH, probably because of hypertension. Hypokinetic inferior wall of LV, mild MR, atherosclerotic aortic valve, grade 1 diastolic dysfunction, and ejection fraction was 53%, and there was no pericardial effusion.
Again, just stop here. Now I request Minal to give your opinion that whether the patient is a risk status, the low, intermediate, or high risk patient, considering all the facts which have been given to us.
There are different ways by which we can go for the risk assessment. One scoring is TIMI system, another is GRACE system. Now, so for the TIMI scoring system is concerned in this particular case, it will be falling in the range of intermediate risk because it will not be going beyond as per the scoring system. Out of 8, it will be around 3 or so. But so for the GRAY system is concerned, definitely it is again in the I think it is in the high risk group. It will touch around 200 plus or 250 plus.
One thing that, yes, you are absolutely right, but so far as the risk scoring is concerned, GRAY score, particularly the GRACE 2, which can be calculated immediately with your from the mobile phone, smartphone, you can calculate the risk scoring. But TIMI score is less sensitive from the clinical point of view compared to GRACE score. Now, Joanto, considering the clinical factors, he's elderly person, persistent chest pain, though the and the biomarker positive, what should you think regarding the patients, regarding the further management?
Along with the conservative management, we should know the anatomy, so at least we should go for a coronary angiography. We'll continue a conservative management. Along with that, we should know the coronary anatomy status, so coronary angiography should be done.
Oh, great. Now we proceed.
Yes. So basically we did a troponin, with quantitative troponin was 2520 and normal was up to 14. So this was markedly elevated troponin.
One more thing, that when the high sensitivity troponin is more than 5 times the upper normal limit, there is a 90% possibility of the acute coronary syndrome. And if it is more than 3 times, there is a 60% possibility of the patient having the acute coronary syndrome. So there, as it is a very, what I say, the discrepancy or the dissociation, the patient reflected from these very high sensitivity troponin level and the normal ECG, there is a bit dissociation. Anyway, appears all these factors, the patient appears to be a high-risk patient. Next.
So serum creatinine and creatine kinase were normal. And if you look at it, it is now...
Jayanto, one more thing, that if the patient with a very high sensitive troponin level, with the impaired renal function, how you will assess this high troponin level? What will be? Though this is not the case in this case, but it is a very important issue.
For the high sensitive troponin, also there is a level above which we can say that despite having the creatinine raised, it predicts the probability of having a non-ST MI. There's a cutoff value for, I don't remember that right now, but for each kit, there is a level above which we can say that the probability of having an ACS is more. Definitely, with a raised creatinine, the chances of having troponin positivity is high. But with high sensitivity troponin, the level, there's a predictive value.
Yes, you are absolutely right. Here, the upper normal limit is 14 of the high sensitivity troponin by this particular assay. Issue you are that even in the impaired renal function in the setting, if the high sensitivity troponin level is high, it might be due to the DEA clearance, but it has been clearly recommended that when the level is more than 5 times or 6 times the upper normal limit, definitely we should take it as the patient having some myocardial damage. Okay, proceed.
Anyway, creatinine and creatine kinase were normal, and this could be because, as you can see here, creatine kinase, they usually get elevated immediately within 4 to 6 hours, and they peak within 24 hours, and they usually come back to normal within 48 hours. So this patient is having pain for 3 days. So because of that, we can get a picture where troponins are elevated and CK-CKMB is normal. So we also did a risk stratification, commonly the TIMI score, which is easy to do. We have this age more than 65, so this patient was 70 years old, and patient had used aspirin also, cardiac enzymes were elevated, so patient came into the intermediate risk category. And as you can see here, more the number of risk factors, the more is the mortality. So this is a 14-day death MI or urgent revascularization rate. With 3, it is 13.2%, and which is quite high. So we gave clopidogrel, we gave aspirin, we gave atorvastatin, we gave IV nitroglycerin, anticoagulation with heparin, and beta blockers were not given because patient had low heart rate.
Dhiman Monik, regarding the anticoagulation, what would be your choice here? Regarding the anticoagulation, what anticoagulation you preferred, anticoagulant?
Anticoagulant, as there is troponin is raised, he may have an course of heparin.
Heparin which? Unfractionated or low?
With a bolus heparin, and then continued with a low molecular weight heparin for 5 to 7 days.
Okay, you are preferring low molecular weight heparin. Okay. Then Shubhro, what is your option?
Well, I think this patient whom we haven't decided yet whether we are going for invasive strategy or not, we can give frontopyrenex, and that would be my choice based on the OASIS 5 result, which has shows a very favorable risk-benefit ratio.
Okay, Minal.
I'll prefer the either unfractionated heparin or low molecular weight heparin, because I am thinking in terms of the intermediate risk or higher risk, so I'll be going for invasive strategy.
Jayanto, regarding the patient has already started with clopidogrel, then do you have any other option, or you just agree that clopidogrel should be given, the choice would be the clopidogrel?
As per as the recent guidelines, we can use ticagrelor, but not prasugrel definitely as pre-treatment until angiography has been done. And but if I talk about myself, I am quite comfortable with clopidogrel.
Okay. Dhiman, the question regarding the GP2B3 inhibitors, whether it has any role here or it should be given?
No. In our clinical practice, we do not use GP2B inhibitor in such ACS after doing the angiogram.
Okay, thank you. Proceed.
So basically, the strategy which is can do in this is you go for a conservative strategy where you don't do an angio. You go for an early invasive strategy where you do an angiography within 2 hours. Or you can do an urgent invasive strategy where you do an angiogram within 48 hours, 2 days. So in this patient, because we did not think of conservative strategy, we did not think of fondaparinux. So we had planned for an invasive strategy, and we actually gave regular heparin. And regarding
regular, you mean the unfractionated?
Unfractionated heparin. And regarding, we did not think that this was a case for early invasive. So conservative strategy is done when patient has no further chest pain, no heart failure, all ECGs are normal and troponins are negative. So this patient is clearly not for conservative strategy. An urgent invasive strategy where you do an angiography within 2 hours, so this patient, I did not feel that this was an urgent invasive strategy, because you do it when you have recurrent uncontrolled severe angina or heart failure or marked ST segment depression or recurrent VTVF. So this patient did not have this also. So we thought that this patient should go for an invasive strategy. And so we did the angiogram next day.
Okay. Yeah. Now, Shubhro, do you agree that the patient, he has just commented that they thought the patient should not... Okay. The patient should undergo the early invasive, not the urgent. Early invasive means within 20 hours. Do you agree to this proposal?
Well, I think if you look at the recent guidelines, the ESG, they have divided into 4 risk groups, a very high risk, intermediate risk, and the low risk. So this actually falls into a group where I would say an invasive strategy is warranted, but doesn't have to be an early invasive, such as like within 24 hours. And still it's 24 hours already over, so I think, but this has to be done within 72 hours.
Yes. Okay, great. Minal, what is your opinion?
I agree with Shubhro, because since he has reported to us after 3 to 4 days of chest pain, we should go for the angiography.
Jayanto?
Do we know the anatomy now?
Anatomy, but now he will show
us.
We should
go for the coronary angiography before.
Before going to coronary angiogram and deciding whether we will do further, so I am asking your opinion that in this setting, what should be the timing of going for the coronary angiography?
This is not a very high risk case. This is a high risk case. Within 24 to 48 hours, we can have an angiography. And then we'll decide.
The patient is not having any hemodynamic compromise, and in fact, as mentioned by presenter, the patient's pain subsided, angina subsided. Okay, you let us know the coronary angiogram.
But I just like to know, what do you think would be the culprit lesion in this heart?
This patient has a very important finding in my mind, as because the patient has got bradycardia, and he is not using any rate limiting drugs. So he may have any critical lesion in RCA or in the dominant LCX, or he may have a left main lesion. As because in a stress test, when the stress test going on, if the patient has bradycardia during the stress test, the patient has got bradycardia. So with these things in mind, as the patient is getting a bradycardia with chest pain, because during chest pain, the sympathetic drive will be more. So patient is normally giving tachycardia, but this patient is having bradycardia.
Okay, thank you, Dhiman. Before going to the invasive coronary angiography, I'm raising a few points regarding whether you can go before the conventional angiography. We may resort to the CT angio. Is there any scope for it, Shubhro?
Well, I think this patient has a troponin a test which is very highly positive, and we already know he has SES. So I think that would be unnecessary radiation dosage and contrast on this patient. I would have gone straight for coronary angiography in this case.
Mrinal?
I'll straight away go for the coronary angiography.
Okay, actually, CT angio is required for those patients who have got the very intermediate low probability for the coronary artery disease and the pain completely subsided. So there's no further rise of troponin. These are the few indications. Now you go for...
Yes, so CT angio we did not think, because CT angio is for low to intermediate, and this is a high probability, troponin positive, echo positive, chest pain. So we entered and did an angiogram actually next day morning, that is on 14th of February. And this is the angiogram. As you can see, a small lesion in the OM artery. And you can see a lesion in the LAD also. But the RCA is filling. Distal RCA is filling. Clearly the PD and the distal RCA is filling. This is another view. The distal RCA is clearly filling. Okay, so the LAD lesion, there was some, we wanted to see it better, so we did another view for proximal LAD lesion. So you can see the proximal
LAD. Have you completed?
No, I'll show the right also.
Oh.
So this is the proximal LAD, and you can clearly see the right coronary PDA filling nicely. Very good filling of the PDA. And I will show you the right also. So right, you can see distal RCA is totally. So it is filling up to the crux. But after that, it's no longer. Total occlusion in the distal part of the right coronary artery. Yes.
Okay. Jayanto, give your opinion. You have seen the coronary angiogram. Then.
So there is a significant disease of the OM and distal RCA.
Hmm.
So both these vessels can be attended. There is no, because the patient is stable, we are not in a haste. We can try two vessel. The LAD didn't appear very significant to me. So we can, for the time being, we can go for try stenting in these two cases. And the other option is definitely surgical revascularization.
Okay, fine. Dhiman?
I want to see the LAD lesion more. Seems to be a borderline lesion in the LAD. About the RCA proximal part, RCA proximal?
Proximal RCA is normal.
Normal, mid part?
Everything is normal. I will show you again.
No, in the mid part there is a lesion. Any lateral view of the RCA?
No. no lateral vein. If the patient is more likely for going for PCI, then LAD should be do an FFR and see the significant of deletion, and OM should be fixed, and RCA, if the distal RCA to be fixed, the proximal mid RCA is to be it also to be stented, I think so, if the PCI is
Okay, option. Supro, your opinion?
Yeah, we can go for PCI in this case, but we have to keep in mind this proximally is a very tortuous lesion. And also like that lesion, I think is significant. So it's not be proper really to ignore it. I think we have to stand that segment as well, apart from the distal RCA and the circ. LAD we can ignore. Of course, if any, we can do an FFR at that time to the LAD, just to convince ourselves.
No, which one do you think is the culprit list?
Then Minal?
I'll be taking care of the RCA lesion, then the OM, and LAD I'll just leave like that because it doesn't, at least from the visual point of view, doesn't seem like more significant.
Then Joanto?
So I have already said.
You have just said. One more issue is that I ask you that regarding the role of FFR in the acute setting.
The role of FFR, I don't think that the LAD is the culprit vessel. However, in the acute vessel, there is spasm of the vessels and also the microcirculation is dysfunctional. So in the very acute setting, FFR is not very useful, at least in the infarct-related territory.
Actually, there is not much data regarding the use of FFR in the acute setting. So it's not very dependable in the acute setting. Yeah. Surip, one thing, that though you are a scientific chairperson, so I request you that in such discussion, panel discussion, audience interaction is not invited. Thank you.
Thank you. But FFR is mandatory. Thank you.
Okay.
Anyway, I just want to know which is the culprit lesion in this case. Which is the culprit lesion?
Before
angiogram, I have mentioned, most likely the culprit lesion is the RCA. Because the patient is having bradycardia with chest pain, and RCA is the dominant vessel. So, most likely the culprit lesion is the RCA.
See, basically, so you feel that this we should do an PCI for the right coronary artery, and one we have an OM vessel also, which is probably of small or medium size, and we should do an PCI of OM. And the consensus all of you said was that the LAD lesion was insignificant, and maybe we should not do it, and if we have an FFR, maybe we should do an FFR.
Okay. As suggested by our scientific chairperson, it should be done, but there are some recommendations and the guidelines, they are not very favoring the FFR in acute setting. Anyway, you continue.
Anyway, so basically this was on 14th of February, as you can see the date here, and we had actually planned an angioplasty of the RCA and the OM as we had planned earlier, but on that very day, the stent prices came down. So the relatives said that can we postpone the procedure so that we can get the benefit of prices coming down. The prices had just been announced and it has not come down officially. So what do you think? Is it safe to leave this patient for one day and do the procedure next day, or we should do it immediately?
Diman, give your opinion. Just what you will do, one sentence or 1.5 sentences? No, you just give the brief now.
We have also faced this situation in our country 1.5 months back after your category. If this such situation appears, it should be postponed and giving the patient on GB2B 3A receptor blocker or heparin.
Okay, Subro?
Yeah, I think this patient has been stable, so we can respect the patient's family wish and wait for 24 hours. I would have done that.
One thing, that this stability might be treacherous. Anyway, yes. Minal, you will always consider two things. I am telling you, the patient is elderly. Another issue, his troponin, high sensitive troponin level is very high. Somehow, this stability may be misleading. Anyway, Meena.
Yeah, exactly. I would like to highlight those two specific points, that the age as well as the very high level of this biomarker is guiding us that we should act as urgently as possible.
Okay, Jayanto.
So we can wait.
Okay, the panelists, anyway, their my experience might be different. Anyway, you continue.
So we had to wait because the prices had come down significantly by about 70%.
But Devanu, I am asking a very frank, honest question. If livid the price of the stent, if there is a nothing and the patient can afford the price of the stent, what would have been your choice, particularly this patient, to this patient?
No, I would have done exactly what I said, as the panel had suggested. I would have probably done an angioplasty of the right coronary artery and the OM.
But there is no question of waiting.
Yeah, so I would have probably not waited. I would have done it same day.
That is a very important issue.
But later I realized that good thing I did not do it. Why I am saying so? Because at 2 a.m. in the night, patient complained of severe chest pain. Again, same day. And the emergency doctor who attended them, they said that patient had marked bradycardia. It was sinus bradycardia. Marked sinus bradycardia, severe chest pain. And in 15 minutes time, patient died. Could not be resuscitated with all cardiac massage. So in retrospect, it is my belief that probably the LAD was the culprit lesion, which we could not probably think earlier. Otherwise, with RCA, which is totally occluded like this, and filling retrogradely, and OM, which is actually a small to medium vessel, a chest pain patient would not have died. It would not have died. The only way the patient could have died is if the LAD was the culprit lesion, and which I had missed, and
panelists also,
because of which this thing happened. So from this case, I conclude that AC, especially non-stem, is something very difficult. You may get a normal ECG. History is most important in diagnosis, as in this case, on the basis of history, we diagnose the disease. ECG may be normal. Which is the culprit lesion is very difficult to decide. And like STEMI, I think also here also, if the risk is high, do not wait. You should go ahead and do it.
Okay. Just a quick comments from all the panelists.
Yes, I have a comment. My intervention career is very small. Maximum of here is my teacher level. I have a comment in this patient. In my clinical practice, typical chest pain with bradycardia, I think the patient has a severe form of coronary artery disease. From the very beginning of in my clinical practice, severe chest pain with bradycardia, I think the patient has a severe form of coronary artery disease.
Okay, Subro?
Yeah, I think the RCA collaterals were coming from both the arteries, from the LAD as well as the SERC. Retrospectively, we think that the LAD could have been the culprit. But initially, I think there was not much way to find out, to say that the LAD was the culprit vessel.
Mm. Okay, Minal?
I think I missed the diagnosis of the LAD because I just labeled it as an insignificant one. I should have thought about the FFR.
Jayanto?
Very difficult to comment why the patient has actually died and which vessel is the culprit vessel. In retrospect manner, if you see that we should have opened the two vessels, but still I am not in favor that LAD should have been attended first.
Okay, but Devanu, do you have anything to comment? Then I will conclude the session.
No, nothing more. I just want to say that it is with so many years of doing interventional cardiology, I joined, started in 89. Still now, I think we need to learn what is the culprit vessel. It is not easy. Thank you.
Okay. Now, before concluding, that our message from this case is that we should first judge the patient clinically. Elderly patient, severe de novo chest pain, another issue, the patient having the bradycardia and a very high sensitivity troponin. We should take it as very seriously of these patients. Coronary angiogram might be in some cases misleading, as it is, we have to judge, we have failed to detect any thrombus in any of the arteries. Have you detected any thrombus in the proximal part of LAD, anything?
No.
Anyway, either the patient might have the spasm or again has a fresh episodes of thrombosis or plaque rupture leading to the total occlusion of the proximal part of LAD leading to the sad event. So we should resort to each patient individually, and any elderly patient, as it has been said in the different guidelines, with such a high biomarker, they should be given at the earliest opportunity the PCI. With these few remarks, I conclude this session, giving my sincere thanks to Devanu Ghosra and also the four panelists, Dr. M.K. Das, Dr. Subro Banerjee, Dr. Joyanto Saha, and Dr. Dhiman Bonik. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Banerjee, and all the panelists and presenter. Now it's official lunch time till 2:30. We'll sharply start the program at 2:30. Two small announcements before that. In our inauguration program today at 7:30, the Vice Chancellor of Ramakrishna Mission, Vivekananda University, Swami Atmapriyananda, is coming. We would ask all of you to come and listen to his erudite lecture. And secondly, beside the registration desk, in the stall of ARC, there will be a lottery in a few minutes' time, where the stakes are a Davidson textbook, Hutchinson's clinical book, and MacLeod's clinical book. So if you're interested, you take part in the lottery, please.